I think it's about time I tried to install another operating system directly onto this Windows 7 phone. Now, Windows 7 does run okay on here, but it's a little bit sluggish at times, especially when it's running at the default CPU speed of 600 MHz. The CPU can run at 1.2 GHz when it's in the dock, or when you do an overclock in handheld mode, but Windows 7 is still not terribly fast on here. To give you an idea of what this is like as a computer, I've taken on a suggestion from a couple of comments and decided to try Skyrim. Thank you for all your comments, by the way. I really enjoy reading them all. I was able to install Skyrim on here fairly easily. It was when I came to run it that I had some real challenges. First, I couldn't get it to run in full screen mode at all. It simply stayed with a black screen. So I had a look at the graphics settings, and I switched them all down to the absolute minimum. Most of them were already set to low anyway. And I also switched it to windowed mode, so that it would start up with an 800 by 480 pixel window. And this seemed to do it. I was able to get to the menu screen and start the game. And it's here we can see just how slow this is. During the title sequence, we're getting about one frame every 4 seconds, which is not particularly playable. I do really enjoy doing these sort of extreme tests though, and it does give a good indication of just how underpowered this computer actually is. And this is running with the CPU clocked up to its maximum of 1.2 GHz as well. So with that test done, it's time to shut down Windows 7 for the last time and get on with installing another operating system. Now, I have checked the backup of the internal drive from the previous video and everything looks good. I can see the recovery partition, I can see all the files, so if I ever need to restore to Fujitsu's original configuration, I should be able to do that. Now, time for a new operating system. And after seeing Linux running on here in the last video, I'm really keen to find a version of Linux that will run well on here. And I've had a lot of awesome suggestions from people in various comments. Some of them I'd never actually heard of before, such as Postmarket OS, which looks amazing and I can't wait to try that. However, for this attempt, I've chosen Lubuntu, which is a lightweight version of Ubuntu. And I've chosen it because Ubuntu works, so it has some proven functionality, and also it's a very general sort of operating system, which is a good way to help learn about this unusual hardware, while I also learn more about the deeper aspects of Linux as well. So starting up the Lubuntu installer, everything looks good, and it does see the eMMC based internal drive as expected. And it even gives me the option to install alongside Windows 7. But I'm not looking for any half measures here. I'm fully committed to this task, so I'm going to fully wipe the internal 32GB drive and install Lubuntu on it. After that, files start copying, and the install goes pretty well. It does take a while, maybe an hour or so. So I just left it going, and then eventually the system just started up. And I'm very impressed overall. Lubuntu uses the OpenBox window manager, which looks nice and clean, and it also uses the LXQT menu system. Looking around, it's fast and responsive, even while running on the default CPU speed of 600 MHz. This is exactly what I'm looking for, and I'm really pleased with the outcome so far. Now, having a look around, there's no GUI option to rotate the screen. So instead, I'm going to use the command line to rotate the screen. So there's a command called XR and R, which will rotate the Windows Manager. It's just a simple matter of entering the command, telling it which display I want to rotate, and rotating right. Now, there are other ways to rotate the screen. One good method is to rotate the entire frame buffer at boot up. But for the moment, I think this will do. Now, I'm keen to test out more of the system, so one of the first things I want to do is set up a wireless connection. However, that's when I realize I might have a big problem. Looking around the system, it looks like no wireless adapter has been detected. And I'm looking through all the PCI devices that the system knows about, and all the USB devices as well, and there's no network adapters at all. I didn't realize this when I was doing the live booting test in the previous video, because I was so focused on making a backup of the internal drive that I didn't really go further and look at the rest of the system. At this point, I had to take a break and do a bit of research, and eventually I worked out that the wireless adapter is connected to the system via SDIO. And Linux seems to have a problem detecting devices that are connected via SDIO. This is something that seems to be a problem with inexpensive laptops and tablets in general. I found a lot of solutions online, and they pretty much all refer to modifying the SD module using a debug quirks command. While I was searching, I found a Japanese blog where someone was installing Arch Linux on this very phone, and they showed how they used debug quirks to get the system to recognize the wireless adapter and get everything working. So I keenly tried this with my system, and I inserted the debug quirks into the grub menu and reinstalled grub. But then when I restarted the system, there was a problem. It didn't even start up anymore. All I got was a blank screen. Sometimes you need the brain of a budgie to learn that spaces don't work well in grub. After getting back in and fixing grub, I was able to get the system booting again. But for some reason, it's much slower now to start up. It's now taking a few minutes just to reach the desktop. Fortunately, when it did, the wireless adapter is now found and Wi-Fi is now working well. Everything is looking good, and it's perhaps a bit slow to browse the web. At this point, I'm reminded by the rotated login screen that I need to find a better way to rotate the screen. I added a frame buffer rotate option to grub, which, when I restarted the system, had absolutely no effect, but at least it didn't crash. So for now, I've just added the Windows Manager rotation option as a startup command. Next, I tried to load YouTube, which turned out to be really slow. The CPU is only running at the default speed of 600 MHz, so I'm going to need to find out a way to clock up the CPU to its full 1.2 GHz. But when I'm able to get a YouTube video to play, it's not even using the full CPU speed, because I think there might be an issue with the video driver as well. Also, I'd really like to get the hibernation working. I did start messing about with this without setting any of it up properly, and of course it crashed the whole system, forcing a battery removal and a cold restart. Linux is great, but I want to learn more of the deeper aspects of this operating system. And this is where I had to make a decision. I'm working with really unusual hardware here, where just starting the system from a cold boot can take a really long time, because first you've got to start up the phone, and then you can switch to x86 mode, and from there boot into the next system. And I'm doing it all on this tiny little screen, which is often rotated and all squished up. So I'm going to do more Linux installs, but on other devices first, and then come back to this one at some point in the future. So for the time being, I do want to try another operating system, and I've decided on the attention-grabbing Windows 10. Now, if Windows 7 is sort of sluggish on this system, I'm expecting Windows 10 to be sort of similar. And I'm not looking to run Windows 10 on here in the long term, I'm just curious to see what it's like. So I put the Windows 10 installer onto a USB stick and tried to boot a few times, but I just couldn't get past the initial Windows logo. I did have to switch to using a DVD drive and a copy of Windows 10 on a DVD to get the installer to start up and run. And with the installer started up, and I reached the drive setup utility, sure enough, I couldn't see the eMMC drive. But I was expecting this, because Windows doesn't support eMMC drives particularly well. So I got the eMMC driver from Windows 7 and loaded it into the setup program. And with that driver loaded, I could then see the 32GB internal drive. So with that part done, the installer started copying the files, and the installation process was on its way. And wow, did this take a while. It pretty much took about 6 hours for all the files to copy and to get to the initial setup screen for Windows. So I had to leave this part and come back the next day. And this is where I started to have another problem. The setup process had a lot of errors, and while I was able to skip through some of the errors, it would eventually not give me the option to skip and ask me if I'd like to try again. So I was getting stuck in an error setup loop. Fortunately, I found the solution is pretty easy. Shift F10 to bring up a command prompt, and then I can use the command prompt to enable the administrator account. And with the administrator enabled, I could restart the system, and it took quite a while, about 40 minutes, but eventually it booted to the desktop. So with Windows 10 fully started, it was time to rotate the screen, which when I did, it pretty much looks terrible and stretched. And this is because there's no display driver, so it's running in a weird resolution and stretching to the screen. So I got the display driver from Windows 7, and I was able to get that installed as well. But that was also quite a long process. It took about an hour just to get the display driver installed. And that's because Windows 10 running on here is really slow. Even with the CPU clocked up to 1.2 GHz, it can still take 10 to 20 seconds just to open a menu. And that's because the main problem is there's only 1 GB of RAM. And this is the newest version of Windows 10 from November 2021. When Windows 10 was first released in 2015, I think they said the minimum was 1 GB of RAM. Well, I think by now, Windows 10 probably needs about 4 GB minimum just to run properly. So considering just how slow this whole system is, I've decided to not try installing the other drivers or installing any software to try out. It's interesting to see what Windows 10 is like on here, but this isn't what I'm looking for. It's just more of an interesting curiosity to see. So with that, I'm keen to learn more aspects of Linux, so I can come back one day and get a proper install running on this phone. So that's it for the Fujitsu F-07C phone. I hope you enjoyed this second trilogy of videos about this particular phone, and I do hope to come back and have a look at it again one day. Thanks for watching, let me know if you've enjoyed seeing this phone, and I'll see you next time.